And I'd like to welcome you to the 26th meeting of the Jacksonville Environmental and Appearance Advisory Committee. I'd like to call this meeting to order. At this time, the members, if you would please look at your attendance record and make sure that the necessary information is correct. Page 12 of the 13. If there's any corrections, if you could please get them to Carla. Next is adoption of the agenda. Is there a motion to adopt the agenda?
So moved.
I second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay, the agenda has been adopted. The minutes. If everyone has read the minutes for June 4th, we need to make a motion to adopt.
I make a motion to adopt.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, the motion has to adopt the minutes. The next item is election of chairman and vice chairman. Myself and Suzanne Nelson have agreed to serve an additional term for chairman and vice chairman. So we need to have a vote, if I could have a vote.
Well, it might be appropriate to have someone make a motion to nominate you and Suzanne for those respective offices and to elect you by acclamation.
I make a motion that we accept Grace and Suzanne by acclamation.
I second.
I guess by unanimous decision.
Well, we got to have to ask for discussion.
Oh, discussion? I'm sorry.
There might actually be some dissension.
Anyone?
You know?
No discussion?
No.
Suzanne?
No, you call the vote.
Okay. By unanimous decision.
Now you ask me to vote.
Oh, please vote. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay.
It's tough running your own election. I'm sure there's a number of politicians who would like to be on the list.
Especially tonight. next, we have energy management and the city. We have Alan Baker from facilities.
Yes, we're going to call Alan Baker up. He is the facilities manager for the city, and he's going to talk to you folks about a number of items in that regard. So we're going to let him have full free range here so he can mark up the screen.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
A little short PowerPoint here. I want to show everybody what we've been doing through the city. Just to give you a little overview, we have 130 plus facilities. It's just another city hall, the Center for Public Safety, which also has the fire stations, police buildings, several rec facilities, water and wastewater facilities, the public services compound, that houses the all the public services, facilities maintenance, streets, sanitation, utilities, and the fleet maintenance. Also a lot of storage buildings and other buildings we have. Little lighting 101 here. HID lighting, it's the high intensity discharge. They have a average lifespan about 20,000 hours. They reduce efficiency over time, the longer they run, the lower light output you get out of them, and they have a higher operating cost. You go to the CFLs, the compact fluorescents, and the lighting that's in your offices right now, the T8 fluorescent fixtures. 10,000 hour lifespan, they have a low operating cost. They use less watts per lumens, which pretty much means you get more light output for less energy out of those. Then you have the top-of-the-line LEDs everybody's talking about these days, light-emitting diodes. Average lifespan is 50,000 hours. They're low cost to operate. They had the best lumen output per watt. Some of the things that we've been doing, this is in the public services complex. Have several energy efficiency projects we've been doing. A lot of lighting retrofits, lighting replacements. We've installed a energy management system for the HVAC and electrical. We've also done some natural gas retrofits from propane and several water conservation kits that we give out to the public to conserve water. Here are some of the projects we've done. This is one of our buildings down there at the public services complex. These had the, say, T12 bulb, which is a bigger bulb that they're trying to phase out right now. There's still a lot around, but we went to the T8 bulb, which is a lower wattage, puts out the same amount of light. We retrofitted all three of these buildings with that. Some of the outside lighting, these had the metal halide type lights. We changed them all out to CFLs and the fluorescent fixtures. We've also added the lighting occupancy sensors and wall switches, which what that does is when you walk in a room, lights come on, they stay on a certain amount. Somebody forgets to turn the lights off, they'll cut off. This is one of the biggest advantages we did when we changed to natural gas at the public services complex. We saved $18,000 that first winter. So that was a significant savings. City Hall here, you see these lights right here, some shoebox lights right now. They have the metal halides in them. And in the future, we are going to change those out to LEDs, and that'll be through a Duke program we have going right now. But in City Hall, we did the energy management system in here through the HVAC and electrical. Installed several occupancy sensors in the offices and bathrooms, storage rooms, several meeting rooms, and we've installed LED lighting, CFLs, lamps on the outside. Another picture of those that are in here. You probably go around and see some of them. This is kind of a snapshot of the software we have for our HVAC system. It's a web-based program. We can look at it on a computer, your phone. We can change things. We get instant alarms if something goes bad. We get an email telling me, hey, this unit's down. So that saves on downtime. And we can schedule the run times. We can cut them off at night. We can cut the unoccupied hours. We can move that temperature on down and keep it off as much as we can. And over a 3-year period when we first started this, it was we had a 10% decrease in the energy in these buildings that we did this to. Jack Amiette, you know, this is an old building that built in 1959. We remodeled it in 2011. It's 9,000 square foot, and we put low flow fixtures in it. We upgraded the electrical. We put new HVACs on the roof. I know a lot of you have seen this before and what it did used to look like, what it looks like today. We installed new lighting with the T8 fixtures and the low flow bathroom fixtures. And the gym lighting, that used to be a 300 watt incandescent, just like the regular screw-in type bulb. It must have been still in there from 59, but this right here is actually it's called a T5 high bay fixture, which puts out a tremendous amount of light and very low wattage, used for especially for gyms. Northwood, you pretty much did the same thing to it. New bath fixtures and upgraded the electrical, repainted and new floors and everything. Same, we put in bath fixtures. In the Commons Rec Center, we did several retrofits over here. It consists of three different, or four different ones, the senior center, administration offices, it's got athletic department and the gymnasium. And we put four 10-ton units in the gym that we're having a whole lot of trouble with. We had them replaced. We also put the T5, the high bay fixtures in here. This had the metal halides in it. And we did the retrofits and all the offices to T8 lamps. New park facilities that are being built today. They all are being built with the energy efficient lighting, LEDs and fluorescents. They already come in with the occupancy sensors, with the low consumption fixtures, toilets and sinks. And this is the Wooten Park. This is one of them that was built that had all that already in it. And also the Jacksonville Landing. Jacksonville Landing also had the parking lot lights or LEDs also. The new public safety building, that is a state-of-the-art building that's been built recently. New Station 2 also, it has all the energy efficient lighting, controls for the lighting. It's got the energy management system for the HVAC. And Station 3 and 4, we also replaced all the lighting in the truck bays and the interior with the new T8 lights, high bay fixtures in the truck bays. Replaced all the HVAC units to the more efficiency models and installed natural gas. Street lighting is something that we're working on right now with Duke Energy. Duke Energy changed out all our fixtures that were over 20 years old free of charge. And that was about 1,500. And I'm sure you can ride around and see a lot of that today. We have about 400 remaining that are still under a contract that we're going to get done at a $50 cost. The benefit we've had is 95% of all this that was done was through a grant that was funded in 2010. We had, a 10% reduction in the building's energy costs over a three-year period. The street lighting costs, we're projecting a 5% yearly reduction on that. And we will continue installing our any energy reduction devices as we go forward. Anything old that we need to replace, we're going to put in either CFL or LED. And that's about it. Any questions we have?
You mentioned something about a Duke program. What is that?
Duke came to us and asked that to conserve energy on the Duke side. Any fixtures we had that were over 20 years old, they were going to come in and replace us for free. And they changed out all the old lighting with the new LEDs. So that was the 1,500 street lights that were replaced.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
From your office, can you tell when a light is out?
I rely on, you're talking about the building lights?
No, like sometimes the street lights goes out.
No, I cannot. I rely on citizens' calls, police department, or citizens that work for the city of Jacksonville usually give us a call. If you can give us a pole number, would be helpful, or address will even work. I know if you're riding down the street, you see one out, please give us a call, and we'll sure take care of it.
I was wondering, what's the cost difference in an LED light versus the one that you were using 20 years ago?
A lot.
The LED has come down a whole lot. The initial cost is about 30% more, but the LED lasts twice as long.
So you feel like you make up the difference?
We do make up the difference.
The length of time?
Yes.
Well, one thing too is that they're not making the old lightings anymore. You're sort of forced to buy the LED light or have a retrofitting to those LEDs because of the energy savings.
Right. Do you think there's any movement? I know whenever you see some of those LED lights, they look kind of blue. like they put off kind of like a different color. It's not the warm glow of the past. Do you think there's any like movement to change? I mean, you would know more than
the technology of LEDs. They've come a long ways, and now you can actually get the color tones.
Okay, so it doesn't have to be that.
The street lighting that you see now out there, even in the street, is a bright white color now, and you can actually they've come.
You can even dim it down from the bright white.
They do have dimmable ones.
Okay, yeah. Well that's nice.
Yeah, they've came a long way with LEDs the last few years.
All right. If you've ever been in a room in the city hall that's too hot or too cold, he's the guy that you can get to fix from his phone.
Thanks, Terry.
None of us can fix.
And he's located somewhere else, right?
Oh, yes.
Or it's nice and cold.
He doesn't have to sit in a lot of meetings.
Well,
more than he likes.
All right.
Thank you. The work of the city planning is next, and we have Ryan King, Planning and Permitting Administrator.
Good evening.
Good evening.
To piggyback on kind of what Alan just talked about, Alan does have to pull permits from our office for the work he does when it requires a permit. So we treat the city folks just like we do anybody in the community. If a permit's required, we work together to give them a permit. And good evening. Glenn and staff asked that I come in and piggyback on kind of what you saw last month, I believe it was, when Gary Willette and Lily here spoke about the code enforcement, zoning enforcement, and the CD program. And the city of Jacksonville, we've had zoning since the 70s, and we recently had a rather lengthy process where we went through with a steering committee and revamped our codes, and as a result of that, there were some code changes. And I wanted to talk tonight about some of those that are probably more directly related to this board. And we'll start this evening with the landscape standards. So when developments come into our office, we review it to make sure that it meets city standards. And that's what I'm gonna go over with you this evening. And with that, we had some tweaks and adjustments that we've made. One of the first examples that I'll show you, just to kind of show you a progression that we've seen over the years, this is the curb here is basically the property line. So right now it goes to asphalt. There's very little grass in the right-of-way, which is basically all of that's right-of-way, but the curb line to here, there was very little grass within the right-of-way, and we recently installed a sidewalk. So what little bit of grass we had went away for the benefit of pedestrian circulation, which is a good thing as well. And over the years, we transitioned, and this is actually right up the street, we transitioned from allowing asphalt to go right next to the right-of-way, which is basically right in here. So a little bit more right-of-way through here. But we basically started requiring an 8-foot street long. And that provided a buffer so that when, you know, if a child got out of the car, there was a little bit of distance between the travelway. If somebody were to get out of the car and trip and fall, there's a little bit more distance there. And also for aesthetic reasons. So that's why if you see around town like this area here, in this location here, which is looking the other direction, it's just a grass strip that buffers the asphalt parking to the right-of-way. Well, some of our most recent code changes, you'll see that now, this is the first bank, this is a new site here in Jacksonville, the first bank, this same area, the same 8-foot area, now has trees and shrubs in it. And that is a requirement of our ordinance. So that's part of doing development here in Jacksonville. We require, basically, there's a ratio that is shown here in this clouded area. That's the street lawn. We also have one here and here because this is a triple frontage lot. That ratio basically consists of 3 large trees per 100 linear feet, 12 large shrubs per 100 linear feet, and 8 small shrubs per 100 linear feet. In situations like this, there's actually a water sewer line that goes underneath here. So our public services department has said, you know, if possible in those areas, we don't want a large tree growing, so we allow a 2-for-1 swap. So one large tree can go to 2 understory trees in situations like that there, where there's a utility line underneath. So you can see the difference over the years. We've gone from, and don't get me wrong, I like green grass, it's pretty, but now we have some shrubbery, and this developer chose to ground cover it with pine straw in lieu of grass. They could do rock, stone, any kind of mulch. That's kind of, they have their option of how they want to do the ground treatment. Just some other examples of the rear street lawn for the same site. Another requirement we have for landscaping is for every 10 parking spaces, we require this island. And in that island, we require one large tree and five shrubs. And in addition to the one island for every 10 parking spaces, we also have a 50-foot spacing. So if you look really closely, you can kind of see some dashed lines around these islands. Basically, the designers of these sites, the CAD technicians, they basically put a 50-foot circle around those islands, and we make sure that at least some part of that circle covers every single parking space. So it's kind of a two-part equation. It's one for every 10, plus every parking space has to be within that circle. That's a much more simple formula before. Before, you used to have to basically, we called it a 1040 form. It was like doing your taxes. You had to type in the amount of square footage of asphalt on your site, the amount of building square footage, and then it multiplied by 12%, and then 50% of that had to be on the inside. It's much more simple the way that we do it now, I can tell you that. There is more landscaping required because of the street lawn requirement that we didn't have before. It's actually a little bit less within the parking lot based on the new formula, but it's much more simple to deal with. So just some more examples of different land treatments in terms of grass and mulch, just grass, just pine straw. This is the Krispy Kreme site, so this is fairly new, and this was back in the winter, so the grass wasn't so green right now, but the mulch and the plants are kind of fresh because they had just been planted. This requirement here actually went away a few years ago. The city council back in the, I believe it was the late 90s, required that the detention ponds have a fence around them. And over the years, city council decided, this is the one in front of the old Lowe's, which is now Best Buy and Dick's Sporting Goods, been there for a long time. The council really thought that this look, right next to Western Boulevard right here, wasn't the most attractive. So we came up with a new standard that the fence is no longer allowed in situations where the pond is closer to the street than the building. And in that situation, they have to design the pond a little bit differently. Basically, they have to build it as an amenity, which has a little bit more gradual slopes versus if they had to put a retaining wall all the way around it where somebody could fall in and have a hard time getting out. So as long as they can build it with gradual slopes, they can still put it up front, like the example here, which is Fire Station 2. You can see this is a nice gradual slope to where if somebody falls in right here when the water's up, it's not like they go over their head right away. Yeah, but there's no fence in its landscaping. Now, you know, this is probably not the best picture to use right now, but this site was just completed, so it hasn't quite taken on. It was also during the cooler, I think it was snowing this day. You see a little snowflake right there on the lens. Because some of the other pictures that I pulled from, there were some snow flurries in the picture. So there's landscaping that's required around the ponds. That's what all this is, along with the street lawn requirements. And there's no fence now.
Does that keep people out of those ponds?
It does not necessarily.
For safety.
The idea is that there's no fence. The reason for the fence was because of the more steep slope, the steeper slopes. So we basically say you can't do the steep slopes any longer. It's got to be gradual, and you cannot have a fence. If you need steep slopes because you don't have enough land, then it's got to go behind the building. That way you don't see it when you drive up and down the road. It's more of an aesthetic deal. But you give the developer a choice. You can do it one way or the other. So it's not that we say you have to do it this way. You have a choice.
Statistically, it doesn't any more accidents that happen for pedestrians or children playing in it this way?
I've been here 15 years, and I haven't heard of a single problem other than I know right up the street from here a car jumped the curb, drove through the fence, and ended up in the pond. And I'm not sure if there was a medical condition that was going on there. I never did hear or if the driver was impaired, I'm really not sure. But that's the only issue that I'm aware of. I take that back. We also had one do the same thing beside the O'Charlies on Western Boulevard. But you figure with 45-mile-an-hour speeds, chain link fence isn't really going to hold you back anyhow. But as far as any children or pedestrians, I have not heard.
People playing in it, you know, just humans playing in it, type
thing. And to be honest with you, I've seen children playing in one before. It was actually, they went through the fence. They climbed over the fence or went through the gate. Okay. So, I mean, it won't necessarily keep somebody out. And in fact, if there was a kid that was struggling here, you know, I think that somebody could rescue, could go in after that child faster under this scenario.
So it's not that deep?
They can get deep. It's all designed by an engineer, and it's to hold a certain amount of water. And
the
amount of impervious surface and how much area in the way that the pond is designed.
The bigger the parking lot, the deeper that water's going to be, right?
Not necessarily. It's probably dependent on how big or small the pond is. The smaller the pond, I would bet, would be the deeper the pond. Because, I mean, there's some that are 2 or 3 acres large. You can see it now that the Jacksonville Parkway is open. There's some rather large ponds behind the Target and the Kohl's, and there's a new one for the Burlington Coat Factory. You know, they're rather large to accommodate the rainfall from those locations. And a lot of times you'll see the bigger ones are actually a community pond, where they serve multiple lots within a development. So just like we have the straight lawn requirement on a linear foot basis, we have a landscaping standard on a linear foot basis around ponds. We also require that buffering be provided between different zoning districts. So if you have a residential zoning district next to a commercial district, the person developing the lot next to the, so a commercial developer would have to buffer the residential zone basically. Before it was based on use. The new code, it's actually based on zoning districts. So if you built a multifamily apartment complex, for example, in a commercial district, before the commercial development building in the commercial district next door would have to buffer that development. Now it's the commercial developments in the commercial zoning, and the multifamily is in commercial zone. There is no buffering between. This is an example of single-family residential back here with a nice berm. Everybody know what a berm is? Mm-hmm. With landscaping on the berm. Of course, it's the fall. So you can see one inherent problem with the landscaping and the buffering is during the fall with a deciduous tree. There's not a lot of vegetation there. But here's an example of some evergreens that don't get quite as, they don't cover as much of the fence, but they are green and provide some buffering year-round. Of course, it's kind of hard to buffer a three-story apartment building on the backside of Sam's Club, too, you know? So, just another example in the same general vicinity along Western Boulevard. So, the City of Jacksonville Code, we actually require that you maintain the quantity and the way that the species is supposed to look. So a common thing that we hear of, if you look at the picture on the right-hand side, is a crepe myrtle, which is the check mark is how a crepe myrtle is supposed to look. And the no sign, that's referred to as crepe murder. That is not the proper way to prune and maintain a crepe myrtle. So the business owners here in town, they're supposed to maintain their required landscaping that was required when they got their development approvals. And they're supposed to protect it during operations and maintenance. They're supposed to maintain the shape, which means they don't go out and top the tree, which is this example here, where they basically come right here and they cut it. It's supposed to look like a tree. So they're supposed to maintain the landscaping in accordance with those approved plans.
What do y'all do about the light and cutting? Do the same thing?
A little bit different standard there. Obviously, we're dealing with that situation. In fact, I was working with our staff today on a similar situation. We built in some criteria with the new code that when we have situations with utilities above or below ground, we would probably look to replace that tree with 2 understory trees. That way, they stay out of the power lines. Unfortunately, there's a lot of places where this is done because they want to keep the lines clear, and we haven't gone out there and replaced it with understory trees.
What if it's on private property and it gets...
Technically, I guess the question is, was it a required tree? If it was a required tree, then we would probably have discussions with them about changing it out to understory. We try to do that during the development review process ahead of time. One of the new criteria that Jacksonville has in our Unified Development Ordinance is design standards. And it's probably one of those things where you may not have recognized it before tonight, and I'll see you here in the coming weeks, and you'll be like, after that meeting, man, I didn't realize that that was what was all over the place. I started looking, I started noticing it. And the first two examples I'm going to give you here is visible rooftop equipment, whether that's HVAC units, whether that's exhaust vents for restaurants like you see here. Actually, you see both. You've got an HVAC system and two kitchen vents. The fence is a requirement of building code, from what I understand, so that people don't fall off the building if they're working on the unit. Another way to combat that problem is to build a parapet wall. Does everybody know what a parapet wall is? Parapet wall, basically, the roof of this building is about here. Right? So they've built this up, and it does two things. It acts as a safety barrier, but it also creates aesthetic. Where you do not see the rooftop equipment. This is probably the very first building, and I think it's getting ready to open up next week, if it didn't open up this week. Does everybody know where the new PetSmart is? Over at Freedom Village?
Yes.
This parapet wall was designed to cover and screen all of the rooftop equipment, and they have probably six HVAC units, and they actually have a few of those rooftop exhaust fans. So all of that is screened with the new design criteria. And the question that comes up is, well, if I have an old building and I'm doing some, I've got an HVAC system that broke, what is the city going to do about it? Well, the question we ask the HVAC companies is, okay, well, how tall is the HVAC unit? If it's an 8-foot tall unit today, well, can you replace it with an 8-foot tall unit or less? And if they can, we let them change it out. If they say, well, we can only put a unit back that's 10 feet tall, which would be making the non-conforming situation worse, we would work with them to put up some roof screening, some rooftop screening. They make some product that basically, if you look at the Longhorn Steakhouse, now that's a new site, but if you're driving around town, if you look at it, we told them that we had some upcoming standards coming up and we wanted to see if they would kind of test the waters and at least screen it somehow or another. And they voluntarily did a roof screening. So if you look on top of that building, there's a tan, for all practical purposes, it's almost like a privacy fence. It's just a tan box. And underneath that, you'll see, if they lifted that off, you'd see the HVAC equipment on top of that building. But they were nice enough to voluntarily comply, and now that the code was adopted, which has been in effect for a year ago, last July, that standard has been in place, and now this building is screened to accommodate that. Now, what it means is it's possible that this wall here is a foot or two taller than what they may have wanted it to be, based on their normal design. So they just raised the parapet height up. And there's also things called sightline studies, and we're working with people on that right now. Burlington Coat Factory, which I'll get to that in a second, is an example of one that we're kind of using as kind of a trial. One of the other things that the design standards has is we require, basically we want to see some variation in roof. You see how it kind of, it goes up, so there's a variation there. It's not just a straight across wall at the top. The other thing is you'll see there's two or three colors. That's another. Basically we have a menu of items. It's basically choose three of the following, and they have the choice. One of them is simple, is just changing the building so that it's not all just one color, say all brown or all tan or all purple or gold. I'd rather see purple and gold. Those that know me will know what I'm getting at there. And
so you basically tell them
what it's going to look like.
Not quite.
Oh. Almost, yeah.
Not really, not quite.
You don't even want to get me started, do you? I'm going to play shut mouth. You go right ahead and give your presentation.
They're really, if you think about what they gave us, and that's probably the best comparison to show. First of all, buildings have all kinds of different standards. This is an example of Walmart. No, this is not our Walmart neighborhood market, but I'm using it for illustration purposes. And you could Google Walmart neighborhood market and look at all of the different designs that they have across this country. And why they choose one for Jacksonville versus somewhere else. I've seen some pretty extensive Walmarts. And from what I understand, our Walmarts are one of the top producing Walmarts in the country. But I would almost venture to believe that we don't have one of the best looking Walmarts. Mm-hmm. But we have one of the top producing, but not one of the better looking. So they have different criteria. And the first thing that the architects and the developers will ask us when we meet with them before they buy a piece of property is, does the city have design standards? Because they know some cities do and some cities don't. So before, when we had that discussion, our comment was, no, we do not have any design standards. So they basically designed it however the architect wanted to design it, and they built it. No big deal. But city council has said, well, we want a small layer of design criteria. And we gave them a menu of options, and they can choose three. And some of it is simple as, this right here would meet one right off the bat because you got a brown, a light brown, a red, a gray. So they've broken the building up with color. That would be one item. The other thing that they've done here is they've got variation in roof line. Very simple to do, but that's another one of our options. The other deals with the entrance area, which most of them are going to have glass storefront and stuff like that at the entrance anyhow. So this is an example of just one I pulled off the internet. Here's an example of one that they're going to build out near White Oak High School. That's not quite as far along in the development process, in the design process, as the one that's being constructed at Carolina Forest. But this meets our standards, and you'll see. You've got the variation in roof. You've got glazing. We require 12% be glass now on every street-facing side. So if you look at this side, if you look at this building, how many streets does this building face by looking at this picture? Three. Mm-hmm. One, two, three. So this is the side that's facing away from Piney Green Road. So this is facing, this is the side of the building. This is the side that's going to be along Piney Green Road. So as you're driving up and down Piney Green Road, how do I clear this off? As you're driving up and down Piney Green Road, this is what you'll see. You can see the front's facing the side as you're driving down Piney Green Road. So if you're coming from Highway 24 on Piney Green Road, this is the view that you will see. So it's a side-oriented building, and we're starting to see more of those. So basically, the back of the building typically are not very pretty sides of the building. So this is going to be the rear of the building, and you can see that it's dressed up quite a bit. There's glazing, and they basically made it look better.
I have a question. Uh-huh. When you increase your design standards for buildings that are new commercial in the area, do you feel like that inhibits like another Walmart coming or a Target or whoever? I mean, are they going to say, no, we're not going to build because your design standards are too high? Or could you, I mean, do you feel like you could say, we're going to continue to increase our design standards and ask for more? Like, I want it to look even better the next time because Walmart can afford it, you know?
That is a very good question.
And so can you ask for more and more is what I'm wondering.
We could. And that would be a council decision. But there's probably a breaking point. And I don't think currently, it's just my opinion because I haven't heard of any yet. Obviously, when you add design standards, it may increase the cost of a building. Mm-hmm. If you increase the cost of the building by too much, they may say it's just too expensive.
Mm-hmm. Okay, as you know, but you go to some towns and their Walmarts are really, they have mountain rock all over the side of it. And right. So I just wondered, where is that breaking point of, you know, how much can, I'm not like looking for surplus, but just where is the point of, you want things to be as good as they can be. So well, I'm just not afraid to ask.
The Walmart on Freedom Village, we actually worked with them when they came through the process. We didn't have any design centers. They asked that question, but our comment was, you know, we have one of the better producing Walmarts. We live in a military community or a coastal community. can't you dress it up a little bit? Mm-hmm. And because we asked, how did you come up with that design? And their comment was, well, we just drove around town, looked at existing buildings, and we just used that as kind of our baseline. And if you're happy with what you have, then maybe that's adequate and that works. But city council and the steering committee, before it went to city council, the growth management plan, all of those things that had been, the citizens had been polled over the years, ever since the growth management plan, said, hey, we need to get some design standards put in place. And so far we haven't heard that the design standards are cost prohibitive, but I'm sure that if we required stone all over the place and it had to be shipped in from Alaska, I don't know that we'd see many new buildings.
Well, that's not what I'm just wondering. You know, you see like Biagio's is a great example. Like they just keep doing more and more and it keeps looking better and better. And I just, every time I drive by, I think, oh, they didn't have to do that, but it looks really good. You know, and I just appreciate, you know, the extra stuff. And it just makes it more fun.
And I think that there's already kind of like with landscaping, there was kind of already a shift where with our old standards, really a lot of the national companies that were coming in, because, you know, we do have a lot of national retailers and restaurants, they were already exceeding our ordinance requirements anyhow. Mm. So really, you know, it's kind of a standard part of doing business. I think if you go anywhere, you're going to see that there's trees in the parking lot. There's going to be some certain design criteria. The biggest thing I think with our design standards now, with the next example, is Burlington Coat Factory. If you look at that building, it's a concrete block building. But they're just about done now, if you pay close attention to it. They've got glass on three sides. Because it's going to front three streets. Now, they will probably tell you that that building costs more than what they were planning to build that building because they had to add glass to it. But our new code requires 12% of glazing. So they had to put 12%, and you can see their calculations right here. So this right here says that our ordinance required 902 square feet of glass. They provided 1,316 square feet. That's on the front elevation. So you have windows here, you've got glass here, and you have windows here, and then you've got them at the entrance of Rackville. So is it more expensive? Is it cost prohibitive? They went over by about 400 square feet. Over 400. Now on the side and rear, they would probably tell you that that costs more for the side in the back of the building than what we had anticipated if they didn't meet with us ahead of time and know that that criteria was in place. So I don't have any other examples. Like I said, a relatively new standard, but very basic menu options.
Aaron, like this Walmart right here, the new dollar store on there by Down East Heating and Air.
Okay, the Family Dollar.
They're going to follow the same guidelines, right? Is this one right here?
There's two sets of design guidelines. Okay, and there's the third piece. I'm not sure when the Family Dollar plan was submitted, but my guess is yes, they will follow the design standards, number one. Number two, it's primarily geared up where you dress the side of the building up that faces a street. So if that Family Dollar is facing one street, the side and the rear of that building is not necessarily going to be dressed up. You will have the higher walls if there's HVAC units on top, but it may not have glass down the sides of the building. But the front will be dressed up. And there's two sets of design criteria. There is a design standard, which is applicable to all commercial businesses. And then there's a large business, which is any building over 40,000 square feet. There's an extra layer of requirements. So in the Family Dollar scenario, that'll be under the 40,000. So they will meet just the section for non-residential design standards. The Walmart Neighborhood Market, which I believe is over right at 40,000, it depends on whether it's plus or minus, would have to meet both. The next piece that is in the ordinance is something we refer to as use-specific standards. And I like to say that this is the one standard doesn't fit all, although we do have some standards that apply to everything. And that's okay, but some of them don't apply to everybody. For example, a standard for a telecommunication tower that's 150 feet in the air, whatever the standards are for that, won't necessarily fit for a restaurant. Because they're not even the same thing. I mean, they're totally different land uses. So we have base district standards, And then we have use-specific standards. And these are additional standards that specific uses have to follow. And the example that I'm going to give you, this is probably one that we've dealt with more than any. That's the reason why I kind of chose this one. I could have chose the cell phone tower, but I thought this might be more fun. Is automotive wrecker services. They're allowed as a special use in the commercial zones. They're permitted by right in the industrial zones. And along with that, and meeting the base standards, these are some additional standards that the only time that this applies is to if you have a towing wrecker service. Hmm. You can only have one of those businesses on a lot. And the reason for that is you can only have 9 cars. So if you have 2 businesses, that means you have 18 cars. If you have 3, that's 27. And you can see how you can begin to mushroom a wrecker storage yard that in some cases the cars will sit there for all practical purposes, you know, junked, because they are going through the litigation process. They're going to end up basically totaling the vehicle, or they're almost totaled, and they got to figure out what body shop they're going to go to. They may sit there for several days or months, as we've seen in the past. So the store's limit's 9 cars per lot. Now, this is not a body shop that's got a different standard. We don't want to see it from any street right away. You got to be 1,000 feet away from one another. 50 feet away from property line, so your neighbor doesn't have to have it right there next to them. There's a type A buffer that's 30 feet all the way around that storage area. You can begin to see that we've kind of pushed them to the back, and we've put them to the center of the lot, and we've screened them so that we can't see the storage vehicles that have been towed from Western Boulevard or Highway 17 or Gum Ranch Road. And basically would not create a significant adverse impact to adjacent properties. So that's a new thing that's only applicable to this one use, and we have multiple use specific standards that only apply to certain land uses. Cell phone towers, swimming pools, recreation, tennis courts, things like that, that buffering may not apply normally, but if it's an illuminated tennis court, we may want to have it buffer or have a buffer put around it if it's next door to a residential neighborhood.
Sounds great. Mm-hmm.
And then signage. We also regulate signage, how much a site can have, the height of the changeable copy. And we have been slowly working with a sign ad hoc committee that this board is represented by Ms. Williams. We've met twice, and we will be scheduling a meeting sometime soon after we can meet with the city manager about the 2 meeting synopses that we have finally provided. Basically, to recap the 2 meetings, we're going to talk about what the sign committee has said. But we talked about things like this, which are sometimes referred to as temporary or window signs, and how we deal with that and the amount that a site can have. This is on Lejeune Boulevard. As you can see, there's quite a bit of signage, and it's kind of distracting. Now, don't get me wrong, Lejeune Boulevard, I mean, it's been here a long time. The road has widened over the years, and it's really kind of crammed a lot of stuff in a small area, and that has some challenges to it. Here's an example. This actually is not in our jurisdiction anymore. It used to be, but these portable signs that are in the right-of-way, we actually go out and pick those up, and they're discarded. We don't return those any longer.
Is that whole grass area
city? So if they move them closer to,
that's a great question.
Taken away?
That's a great question. If it's on private property, we will not go onto private property to remove the sign.
Okay.
If they're in the right of way, we will confiscate them. Okay. Now, if they're on private property back here, if they are in violation, we will send them a violation notice. If at first they have not complied based on basically a conversation with management or the owner. We try to knock on the door and say, hey, I'm not sure if you're aware that the city has regulations. And that's what Gary does, as he kind of explained last meeting, that, you know, him and his staff, they will basically try to say, hey, look, we're not sure if you know that we have an ordinance against that, or here's what you can do. But if this was a violation because of being temporary and more than one, then we would basically say, hey, look, you can have one of these temporary signs, and they have to be on your property. If but all on, kinds of different rules with signage.
If it's on their property, as opposed to being on the property line, what's the difference as far as aesthetic?
I would say that there's probably not a whole lot in terms of aesthetic. It's probably the same, whether it's here or whether it's here. Right. It's just legally, we will not trespass and remove a sign off of private property. Now, the closer you get to the street, it's possible that it becomes more of a safety concern. Mm-hmm. One of the concerns we have here is, you know, you can get an afternoon thunderstorm during the summer with a little bit of winds, and if they're not quite secured, the best one could lift up and go flying into the street, and somebody could end up having an automobile accident. But we also understand that there is some benefit to having temporary signage. And that's some of the things that we're working on the sign ad hoc committee with, that we'll go back to city council with. How do we juggle this scenario? This is another example, and this is just really to be an example. 831, I think this was right after we had a tropical system that moved through. And I'm not saying that this person, I'm not even sure who it is, which is good too, that after a storm or if a business closes down, we ask that they at least put some sort of a panel in there so that we don't just see support framework and the lighting, the light bulbs. And this was just an example. We do, we canvass the community after storm events, clean the streets, look for damaged structures, et cetera, in case they need a permit from us, and just to make sure everything's good. And so staff took the picture on August 31st back in 2011. And I just use that as an example that basically they would have to put a sign face in it. I know why it was blank here, and you know, we give them some time to do that. But if a business had closed down and then just left it like this, we would send notification to the property owner to put a face in it or remove the sign. One other item, and this is I think my last slide, and it's very simple. We do have an exterior lighting criteria standard now. And it's pretty basic. Duke Energy, for all of their sites, prepare these plans. And this is actually a new site. It's an old site, but a new development. Does everybody remember where the Marine Federal Credit Union was on Bryn Mawr Road? Mm-hmm. And right now it's just a vacant asphalt parking lot. This is a proposed development that we're in the process of reviewing right now. And this is going to be a 6 or 7 unit office building. So you can see there's little cubicles here. Mm-hmm. So that's like a 6-person office or 6 office. Mm-hmm. And so you'll be able to rent those out if you need office space. So this is a proposed building, and they've got the landscaping that we've talked about. See all the pretty landscaping all the way around it? Because this is a perimeter lawn. This is a 4-foot lawn with smaller trees and shrubs. Mm-hmm. And then you have the street lawn here because there's 2 streets. And you got the islands and you got the circles. Although this circles is for lighting. So basically what the city says is you can't go any taller than 30 feet with your light pole in commercial zones. And then when you're close to residential, we limit that to 16 feet. One of the best examples to see it, and we've tweaked the code a little bit, it's not quite as strict as it was, and that was by staff design. If you look at the Taco Bell in front of Williamsburg Plantation Apartments, those lights I think are at 12 feet. Chewy's. Because it abutted a different type of zoning district at the time, they had the limited lighting, and they actually, even though it wasn't necessarily applicable on other sites, they went ahead and did the shorter lights across the development. But 16 feet for some, 30 for others, and the light output, like Alan was just talking about, you know, those LED lights are bright. Well, they basically throw a light on the ground. So what the city has said is, in this scenario here where you have commercial or industrial on both sides, and then you have a street here and here, that at the property line, which is right here, the maximum the lighting can be is 2.5 lumens, or I'm sorry, 2.5 foot candles. And you can measure that at the property line. Looking at this plan earlier, I don't even think it's at 2, I think it's closer to 1.6. So they meet our standards, you know, and then some. So it just keeps, you know, there's a lot of people where you've got residential houses that are fairly close. There's a lot of light pollution, a lot of, you know, light spillage. With the standards now, we kind of say, look, kind of keep it on your property. Keep it under 30 feet. We also require dark sky standards. We want the light poles basically facing down. And the primary reason there is to protect the military mission. because, you know, when you're flying a helicopter, if you've got lights that are just blaring up into the sky, it could impact the flight patterns of the helicopters and the Ospreys, the military. So I believe that's my last slide. You have any questions? I know I covered a lot in a little bit of time. All right, thank you. I appreciate you having
you
me out
much.
Tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we need to get our subcommittees. If we could have Patrick Carroll from the recognition committee have any notes.
Let's see if I can pull it up. This is your nominating form. You can now either put it in by writing, call the city hall, and now it's also on the city's website that you can actually put the application nomination to me on the website. And I have to do the paper form. You can do it online. The nomination this month for residential is the Tyrone Willingham residence over on, I think it's LP Willingham Drive over in downtown.
Mm-hmm.
This is who the committee chose this for the next recognition award, Green Star Award.
Which will be presented at the August 18th meeting. So any of y'all that can be there, that would be great.
Beautiful.
It's beautiful. Thank you, Patrick.
Okay.
And from that planning subcommittee, Linda?
Okay. Our committee met before this meeting, and we're going to have our citywide cleanup in September. We're going to focus on paints, and we're going to try to have a list of hazardous materials to let people know what's hazardous and how to get it ready or prepare it for pickup, and especially on the paints. We're going to have a backup in October if something happens that we cannot do it in September. We're also going to let them know the days they'll pick up, and the city will be doing the flyers again. It will be done on their regular route, so they won't have to think another day, but we'll let them know what day of the regular route they'll be picking up. For the breakfast that we were going to have for the sanitation department, we still, the Hampton Inn has been contacted, and last year Panera Bread helped out.
Mm-hmm.
It will probably be around 6 a.m. It's going to be when the time changes, and that's why we're going to do it in September. We want to let them know not to bring their own breakfast this time or not to eat before they come, because we had something with that last time. They were all full and had coffee and everything ready. We talked about in our meeting of going back and doing something for recreation and parks.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something we'll look at in our next meeting. Our next meeting is going to be the 15th of September at 10:30. And we're going to do our final planning and date for the breakfast. I think that's it.
Okay.
All I have.
Thank you. Glenn?
Well, the next item from the staff is just to bring you a little up to date about the a couple of items, and among them is the Lejeune Greenway and Trail. And there's no pretty pictures to show you here because construction hasn't started, but the good news is the bid award has been approved by the City Council. There was a little hiccup in that the amount that the had come forward there did not include enough to have for some overhead charges that the state charges us to do their project, as it was. But that's all been handled now, and so we're hoping that construction can begin shortly and that project can get underway. Now, on the Louise Sunshine Williams project here, that would be called the Beirut Memorial Grove. That is, she checks in with Mike LaCorey all the time on this one. They have been making considerable progress. They have focused this week on the hillside and planting roses there. They're going to be red and yellow roses. And so there'll be 200, basically a number less than 300 there, but they're going to look at about 273. They're trying to make that number, but they're working out as they go. This is an example of some stuff that was left behind by the other contractor. And what was found on the site, obviously those large, construction debris has not made it very easy to manipulate in the area and till the soil and do things like that. So this has been quite a challenge. The city also went in and had all the irrigation fixed. So now it is fixed, it's marked in such a way they'll be able to find it again, and it's working. So that's the other part that is going on there. You can see some of the examples of some of the equipment that they're using there. They're also evaluating what type of resources they're going to need when they bring the trees in too. So this is helping them, because just some of the access to the site, as you know, has not been the easiest as it is there. The rain, the heavy couple of rains we had didn't help, you know, in the soil prep world out there, but they are progressing along. They're making good progress now.
I saw that today. It looks like it's through. I saw it tonight. Looks good.
We have been, you wanted some before and after pictures. So we have before and after pictures. This is after. So they've got the stuff on land, on site now, and they're moving it around, and this really is starting to look nice as it is there. Toward the end of that, the trees, if you recall when Michael sat before you at last time, how excited they were to have gone to Tennessee. Mm-hmm. They did actually touch not every 300 trees, but they picked out the 300 trees that they're going to get. Remember, only 273 are going to be planted, and Betty can give you the math on all that, but she's got that memorized. But they're going to set those other aside, and they're going to be growing in a place, so should they have to replace them or do something like that, they'll be able to do it. As you know, the city does have a tree spade. They don't really like to use it for that type of purpose, but they'll be able to do something in there. Understand that most of the mortality would come in the first 2 years after they're replanted, as it is. So that goes from there. So this is really, really moving along, and as Ms. Sunshine said, they're trying to advance this site and make things work.
Was this recently? We passed by, I think, a couple of days ago.
Tonight it was shining pretty.
Oh,
a long way from Wilmington. If you can come in back into town, it is beautiful already.
Okay.
Trees are not there, but this is.
Okay.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
They are to be commended every chance they get, because it is going to be magnificent. Already the city is.
This is a good thing.
And all you citizens out there need to call up City Hall and tell them how much you appreciate the way our city is looking with all the greenery you see.
Say that after these next couple of slides. Let me show these first. Let me show these first, and then you say that, okay? These are the islands that are out here in between the City Hall out to Lejeune Memorial Gardens. I think that now Miss Sunshine's address makes even more sense.
Yes.
You know, they're putting seasonal plantings, but they're also, as you can see, some permanent plantings in there that'll really help out as it was. Some of them have raised beds, and some of them have other enhancements, such as the crepe myrtles and things like that, that'll, you know, really help as it is. This is what was described as the final phase, the Freedom Fountain. This is the flag garden. Yes. And as you saw there, we actually had to have Duke Energy come and move some lines and do some things out there. This, now over here, we talk about what Parks Division has done. Facilities maintenance had a significant role in helping in this project here with installations of the flagpoles. And you did something else out there too. What else was it? That big old
one. Oh, yeah.
Anyway, what we want to make advocacy for is getting some of these overhead lines out of here, but that's a fairly expensive process there, but it's something that has been on the deal. So I hope that y'all agree that this is looking a lot better. The state hasn't turned this over, as I understand it, yet to the city for the maintenance of this site. And already Richard's talking about wanting to make some enhancements in there, so I'm sure Mr. LaCorey and his staff will be going back. And this is a view back towards City Hall, the other matter there, but you can see of the same island that we started with, as it was. So we just thought you'd like to have these nice views, as it was.
Please, call Dr. Woodruff, call your city councilman, and call and let these people know how much you appreciate our tax dollars going to make our beautiful city look beautiful. We've been working on this for at least 25 years, and look what we've got, a beautiful, beautiful city. please let those telephones ring. Thank you.
Y'all feel like you're at a telephone?
Yes.
Yes.
No. Tell them I'm Richard Bouchet.
Call Carl. But toward the end of that, we didn't have an up-to-date picture, but I hope you've seen what's happened on Huff Drive. They've started mowing that. The parkway is now being mowed. They also took a big step in mowing over there at the interchange of Marine Boulevard and Martin Luther King, Coretta Scott King intersection there. That was a huge task getting that done. And Michael LaCorey has wanted you to see, particularly where they did some knockdown mowing in some areas it's going to be hard to get to. And then they did some more finer mowing where you stop at intersections where you'll be there for a period of time and doing something.
Right there in New River. They did magnificent on that triangle right there.
That is gorgeous.
That had been attempted 20 years ago, and now it's magnificent right there. Beautiful, beautiful.
Sometime you'll have to get, we should have gotten that picture of that. Lisa, we'll have to do that.
Yes, it's beautiful.
But the staff has been approached about, by some of the residents there about helping them to grow things there. They were most amazed by some of the questions they had. But Madam Chairman, that's just kind of an update as to some other items that you asked to be talked about there.
Thank you. We're not going to have a planning and advisory board comments since Suzanne Nelson is in.
And we had a full dose of planning tonight. It's good. It's all good.
Okay. Our next meeting will be Thursday, October 1st at 6 p.m. And anyone motions for the meeting to adjourn?
A motion to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Second.
Meeting's adjourned. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.